meeting for the Community Preservation Committee. A couple of preliminary matters to address. First, I see you there. We need to do a roll call confirm that all members and staff we anticipate were on the agenda or are present. So we'll do a roll call. Call your name and you have to state your presence, whether or not you're present. We're going to go alphabetically. Paul Albert, he's absent. Barnes.
Present.
Crocker.
Present.
Dermody. Bob Dermody, present. Okay, we're having a hard time. You're on, so remember, get hit mute. You know, when you want to speak, you got to click off mute. Okay.
I am present.
Okay, good. Dorfman? Okay, Laura's not here. Herzl?
Present.
And Chair Pingentor, present. Staff, when I call your respond in the affirmative. Karis Lustig?
I'm here.
And Kristen Wright?
Peter, Laura's here. She just chatted back. We're just having some technical difficulties, so I'm going to email, text her, and see if I can get her to log so we can see her and hear her.
Great. We'll pause just for a minute or two.
Peter, just you didn't ask if I was here.
Sorry, Rick.
That's all right.
No, I apologize. Zambone.
No, I'm here.
Okay, present. All right. Good catch.
Laura, can you hear us?
There was Artie.
Got my Hawaiian shirt on for the occasion.
Peter, for the purposes of the roll call, would the text that I got from Laura suffice? And then we can see if we can get her so she can communicate both ways. She can hear us, we just can't hear her.
Great.
Okay. Yes.
So Laura Dorfman's present. All right. Good evening. This open meeting of the Conservation Committee is being conducted remotely, consistent with Governor Baker's executive order of March 12th. 2020 due to the current state of emergency in the Commonwealth due to the outbreak of the COVID-19 virus. In order to mitigate the transmission of the COVID-19 virus, we've been advised and directed by the Commonwealth to suspend public gathering. And as such, the governor's order suspends the requirement of the open meeting law to have all meetings in a accessible physical location. Further, all members of public bodies are allowed and encouraged to participate remotely. The order allows public bodies to meet entirely remotely, so long as reasonable public access is afforded so that the public can follow along with the deliberations. Ensuring public access does not ensure public participation unless such participation is required by law. This meeting will not be for public comment. For this meeting, the Community Preservation Committee is convening by Zoom app, as posted on the town's website, identifying how the public may join. So please note, events here, that the meeting is being recorded and that some attendees are participating in the video conference. Be aware that other folks, and that take care not to screen share your computer. Anything that you broadcast may be by the recording. With respect to materials, all of those materials have been provided to members of the body, available on the town's website, as we otherwise note, and tonight consists entirely of the agenda. Anything that, the public is encouraged to follow along using the posted agenda unless I note otherwise. Here are some ground rules. We only have, I think, two agenda items. I'll introduce the subject. I think Karis will probably, we'll go with our staff member, Karis, to offer some opinions with respect to the issues that would come up. And then after that, I'll go down the line with each of the members and inviting each by name to provide any comment, questions, or motions. So hold until your name is called. And then just a reminder of what I had brought up prior to the commencement of the meeting, which is to mute your phone or computer when you are not speaking. And remember to speak clearly and in a way that helps generate accurate minutes. For any response, please wait until the chair yields the floor to you and state your name before speaking. Okay, so tonight's agenda. Begins, the first item is discussion about public hearing. We tentatively, we have scheduled presently for April 2nd, a public hearing for the seven articles that we're considering and voting on to be placed on the warrant for town meeting. We've had some discussion, I've had discussions with our staff members regarding two things. One is the actual schedule of when the town meeting is going to occur and what it is that we can do to facilitate, I would call it an expeditious town meeting, an efficient use of our time. We anticipate probably going into town meeting sometime in June. We still may be dealing with the after effects of the COVID-19 virus. And there's some concern about the length of town meeting. So there's been some discussion about what we can do to shorten. And so that's one issue. Second issue that's come up is we lost some time because of the COVID-19 crisis. We had a meeting that was scheduled, it was canceled. Similar events had occurred with other committees, and the result of it is the Finance Committee is going to meet on April 15th, and I think has anticipated on its docket as many as, if I'm correct, 30 items that they're going to be reviewing. So seven of them would have been ours. So that's an enormous task for the Finance Committee. Just to let you know, we're required to have these warrant articles, potential warrant articles, reviewed prior to a vote by us. So it could be after public hearing, but before we can vote as a committee, the Finance Committee has to review. So we're looking at an April 15th date where they are confronted with 30 articles that they have to review. So the discussion, I guess there are two discussion points that I'd like to open up. And first, I want to turn to Karis to give us a little more depth to what I've at what I've laid out here. But the discussion item is, how does the committee feel, I'll just say generally, about the idea of putting these warrant articles on what's going, we anticipate to be a special town meeting that's going to be in the first week in October. And it will hold, it's going to have a number of articles. So we're going to try and, if you will, skinny down regular town meeting to get through it. And then hopefully be in a better position health-wise come the first week in October. And so we can have a more substantial special town meeting at that time. That's kind of the discussion point that we have now. If we go that route, in order to get all this out here so everybody can have their discussion, we can have kind of a single round, if you will, but I'm not saying that that's what we should do, but just to be efficient. If we go that route, what I would anticipate is that we would have a public hearing sometime in August, which is good. You've been following the news. We'll probably be through this first round of problems with the virus beginning in August or by August. And if we have a town meeting in the first week in October, that's also good in terms of timing, because some of the public health experts that I've heard have said that it's going to be returning again in November. So we may have another crisis to deal with beginning in November of 2020. But what we might be able to do is sandwich in a short town meeting both in May and then in October, and a public hearing on our matters in August, and have it done so that we can have a full participation by the public. If we have a public hearing now on April 2nd, it's going to be done by, I guess, Zoom or some form of that. I guess that's how it would done. But we've got a couple of warrant articles that people want to talk about. People want to participate and have a discussion about the two articles by the churches, the First Baptist Church and First Parish. And probably to afford, if we have that opportunity, depending on what everyone else thinks, but if we have that opportunity, it might be better to do it in person if we can work it out logistically. Let me just add one other thing. First of all, too, let me just start by saying, remember, I'm a trained advocate. Okay, so just you're going to see kind of my perspective coming through here, I don't want to spoil the process, if you will. But I want to get out all the issues. If we extend this out until August and then a vote in October, it would provide us, assuming that we are going the way we're going with the two church articles, it would provide us with an ample opportunity to address the restrictions that we would want to have in connection with the funding, so that we could probably be in a better, we could have some clarity in terms of what the agreement actually looks like. It would be a little bit of a scramble between now and May or now and June, a little bit, to have that buttoned down and agreed to. But if we have a little more time, if we've got a vote, we know where we're going, we know what the conditions are that are attached to it, then we'll have ample breathing room to actually come up with an agreement. So, but look, you're all very experienced town meeting members. You know that we've had town meetings where we've seen a signed agreement sitting on that table, and there are town meetings where we've seen a promise and a representation about what the terms and conditions are going to be. So we've seen both of those things. I think ideally we'd want to be in a position where we would say this is what the agreement would look like, this is what they would be signing, or it could even be signed subject to authorization. So that would be ideal. And I'm not saying that we can't get that if we still want to go through June, but it's just one of those factors to consider. I think that I've covered it. And what I'd like to do is turn it over to Karis for her to add. And I'm going to mute now. Let's see if I can do that following suit. Okay.
So I think, as Peter said, and I'll just add briefly to it, is the idea would be to bring the same process, but instead of with the target of the annual town meeting, targeting the fall special town meeting. we would still go through the same public hearing process. We've actually already met with the select board, so we wouldn't need to, you know, readdress these articles with them. And then meet with the finance committee. They typically have a meeting at the beginning of September to vet the special town meeting articles. So we could meet with them then. And it would give the opportunity for the public meeting to be more of a public meeting as opposed to this modified public meeting that we're talking about doing with the Zoom process. And obviously it requires people to have access to that kind of technology to be able to participate. And given, I think, the two articles in particular that are highly have a lot of questions around them, it would kind of limit our ability to fully vet those questions out before going to town meeting, as well as the thought that town meeting, and I think when we met with the select board yesterday, it was before the governor made his announcement today about closing schools through the beginning of May. They're going to be taking the issue on about postponing the town election and potentially the town meeting, that having a later town meeting, you know, our town meeting usually goes 3 or 4 nights. If we have a later town meeting, we'd want it to be shorter. So that way we're able to process all the decisions of town meeting before we go into the next fiscal year. So that's sort of the thought, both for the advantage of the CPC, but also for the advantage of the community at large. There's a little bit of precedent. We have voted articles before for CPC at the special town meeting in the fall. Certainly articles sometimes where the construction is happening at the very beginning of the season. We've wanted to get the money in the fall so that way we could go through the bid process in the winter and start the construction maybe in April or May. None of the projects that we have are in that situation, but I don't think any of them would be on the town side would be critically impaired by delaying it by a few months. So with that, I'll turn it back.
Yeah, I just want to add, by the way, that this kind of idea is coming. I've heard this recommendation that we continue the matters until October has come from our executive staff, from Kate Fitzpatrick and from Karis. So there's some element in my mind of deferring to their opinion, if you will. I just want to let you know what the origin of it was. They're trying to manage this process as they go along. And so one of the proposals that they have come up with in terms of managing the process is to limit or take some of these articles off of our May or June, or hopefully not later, but June town meeting. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in alphabetical order. So Rick, you get to speak last. And I'm going to call your name, and then we'll get input from you. And then it won't be your last opportunity to speak. I think we're a small enough group that you can raise your hand if you do want to speak again, or take off mute button and say, I have something to say. So let me start. With Joe Barnes. Where is Joe? Joe's there.
I'm here. I just took the mute button off. I had initially thought that getting our approval for our proponents of those articles would help them to move forward during the summer, take advantage of the reconstruction, the building, whatever had to happen. But after thinking about it and hearing you, Peter, and most especially Karis, it seems to make sense that given the sensitive nature or the feelings that may be running, especially on the two church proposals, it does make sense to give those articles time, and to do it right. I would not want to have anyone come back at us during town meeting or at any time saying that we were forcing it down their throats or we hadn't given careful thought. I think there has to be the opportunity for a very open hearing, literally an open hearing, so people have chance to hear from us and also have chance to speak themselves. So I would be of the opinion that yes, we should allow this to be delayed for a special town meeting, let the process go in a reasonable and thoughtful fashion. That is it.
Sorry, thank you, Joe. We're gonna move on to Artie Crocker. Artie, you gotta unclick your mute. And
hey, Pete.
Hi, how are you this evening?
Good, Pete. How are you guys doing? Yeah, it certainly sounds like make sure there's a thoughtful process going on to have, I don't know about all the articles necessarily, but I mean, certainly some articles which would take longer. I don't know if it's possible or if we've given any thought to breaking it up where there's some of the articles which probably are not very, I don't know, I'll use the word contentious, or might very well just pass with unanimous consent. Perhaps having those go on at the earlier town meeting. I don't know if it's possible to do that. Certainly from a time-wise standpoint, it probably wouldn't mean much as far as the fall town meeting if they're left there. You know, again, if it's unanimous consent, it's a matter of reading a number and then that's how much time it takes. From a visual volume standpoint, it decreases what people are seeing. Maybe that matters, maybe it doesn't. If you put those on the earlier town meeting, I don't know if that's possible. But again, I agree that considering everything that's going on and to make sure that the public has a real thorough chance to hear what's happening before the town meeting, it makes sense to put off at least some of the articles. I don't know about all of the articles, but I certainly agree it makes sense to put off some of the articles to the fall town meeting. And I think that's probably all I have to say about it.
Okay. If I may, just chair's prerogative, if I can just respond with my thinking on that. So I agree with you that some of these articles are so lacking in controversy that they may be passed by unanimous consent. But if we lose a little bit of the efficiencies that we would have by grouping them all together, we'd still have to have a public hearing now, April 2nd. We'd still have to consult with FinCom now, April 15th. And we'd have to assemble up there, we'd have to assemble, et cetera, have our meeting. So I think that I think we lose something on the efficiencies. And you know, I haven't heard anything from the proponents which suggests that a delay of 3 or 4 months is going to really adversely impact them. I do think that I respect your thinking on that. That's kind of one of the problems that I see with it is that it's one of the things that I liked about our proposal was it's kind of elegant in that we don't really have to do our work over again. None of our work is lost.
Hey, Pete, if I can break in. I forgot to mention what you had just mentioned, that is, if none of these articles are time sensitive, that it creates a hardship or it creates additional cost by waiting, then certainly I don't see much, if any, benefit of splitting that up then. And certainly getting back to the efficiencies of what you're referring to, Peter. So it's certainly something that worth thinking about, but beyond thinking about it for 15, 20 seconds, perhaps isn't any more than that. Perhaps isn't.
But I respect your thinking on that. That's good. So I respect that. Okay, so we're going with Dermody next.
Thank you, Peter. I respectfully disagree with my colleague, Artie. I don't think we should split these up. I don't think we can. We need to treat them all fairly. There's no way we can determine how they will go. I think we need to stay away from words like contentious or easy or unanimous consent. That's not for us to decide. I also would like to concur with my colleague, Joe. I think we should use the recommendation of the town manager and what Peter had described at the beginning to push them all back at a revised schedule. I think we need to remember our proponents and all of the town constituents and to try to do the job the best we can. I believe we're in a position where we can do this, whereas other people or other town warrant articles may not be as easy to do this. So I think we should use that opportunity as an opportunity to protect the due process. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Bob. Laura Dorfman?
Can you hear me? Yes. I just have two thoughts. One is, I think everyone understands why there would be a delay in something like this. So I don't think there would be any question by any resident or constituent about having, you know, pushing this off so that it can go through its due process. The other thing I just want to say is that we need to be mindful of some of the financial impacts of this virus that could impact some of these projects between now and then. There's going to be job losses. There's going to be people who won't be able to make their contributions to the churches between now and then. I know it's a short period of time, and there's nothing we can do about it, but we need to sort of keep that in the back of our mind, that things could really change a lot for support from the membership, or I don't know what the word is because I'm Jewish, for the parishioners, thank you, in terms of how much they can support the church. That's just something we have to think about.
All right, again, I'll just kind of exercise chairman prerogative, if I may. That's an excellent point. One thing I'll point out is with the First Baptist Church, their revenue stream is largely based on the lease that they have. We saw their budget, it's quite lean.
Right.
And so, and they have a substantial endowment. So I think that they'll be fine, but it's an excellent point. And I can't recall First Parish, but I know it's been here for, I don't know how many hundreds of years. I'm sure it'll probably survive this, but that's an excellent point. I guess what we could do, you know, we could consider this at a later point, is ask each of those, it would be the parishes, because those are the entities where we wanted to examine their financials. Going into August, we can ask them for a first quarter or Q1 update on their financials. Okay.
And if I may, just one more time, it may be if there is an impact, we don't know. There's so much, you know, ongoing talk about support from the government and the community. So it could be that we look at this a little differently if that's the case at that point in time. You know, maybe we say these groups really need this help now, and maybe that changes how we look at it.
Okay.
Because what we're talking about isn't going to go on into perpetuity. Thank you.
Excellent points. Okay. Chris Gerson.
Oh, there I am. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you.
Okay, sorry, I didn't hear his response. I'm kind of split 50-50 on this. I can see the good points that, you know, Dermody brought up, and I can also see the good points that Artie brought up, is that, and Peter, you kind of took the words out of my mouth, it'd be almost worth asking some of the proponents, could you wait? I just know kind of wearing my park and rec hat right now that Ed Olson, for some of the projects that he's had set up, like the track resurfacing and the Claxton Field renovation, those are things that maybe he had on his calendar that he wants to get the scope of the project in now because he's looking to do construction next year. So is that going to postpone something further down the line? That whatever we push off for now, we're going to have to do in October if we have a special town meeting. So if there is a possible way to break them up to kind of ease the load for the later town meeting, it might be a possibility about doing something like that. But I do also see that you want to be consistent. If you're going to push all the articles off, you push all the articles off. If you keep some, you split them, see what you can do.
All right, so I'm wondering if it's okay if we can have Karis jump in. Remember, she kind of works hand in glove with Ed, so may be able to speak to those issues. And also just bear in mind that the suggestion that all of these be continued until October originated by the town, the staff of the town. So with that, I'll turn it over to you. You can offer any insight. What I'll say is that your expressed concerns about timing and how it might impact the plan is for the town. Karen?
Yeah, so I can only speak to the ones that the town submitted, but two of the three of them are design-based projects as opposed to construction-based projects. Having worked before with Ed on some of these, I believe that if we were to get funding in October, he could still get design done over the fall. So that way construction could be bid in the early spring before town meeting. The project for the Conservation Commission is a design project as well that doesn't have any specific construction funding that they're looking for at the moment. So I don't think it would delay any secondary construction. The one thing that probably would be delayed would be the resurfacing of the track. I imagine that Ed was planning on doing the construction work this summer. And then that would be obviously put off until the following summer when temperatures are appropriate to do the treatment that he was looking for. Oh, sorry.
All right.
There you go, Chris.
Chris, you want
to ask a follow-up question. So in regards to the community farm, there were plans of them coming back the next following year for additional funds for another project. Would that kind of hold up their plans of what they want to do? I mean, it's, for lack of a better term, small money for something, and we know there's no guarantees that this will go through, but with the amount of the proposal, it seems like it could be a very easily passed thing. Again, no guarantees, but I mean, that could then prolong what their plans are years down the line. So that's why I'm saying there are some that might be worth breaking up.
So I guess, I mean, you raise a good point. I'm worried that there were, that we are going to look like the playing favorites. That's one. I'm really, I'm concerned about that. And I'm looking at kind of a, somewhat of a shared burden. The other thing is that I realized too that there's going to be one benefit to having a controversial item is that we're going to get a bunch of people out who are going to hear about a whole lot of other things, including the community farm. And they're going to be educated about these other good things that we do with CPC and the other good things that these proponents do with CPC funds. So it's kind of a forced audience. I don't know, you may think that that's not much, but when I heard, Joe Lakehorn's presentation, that was pretty powerful stuff. And so if he's going to be making that presentation at a public hearing where we have 50 or 75 people instead of five, there's some benefit to it. But I do understand your concerns. Again, we lose that efficiencies that we would be trying to shoot for in terms of encumbering the work of both FinCom and the town. But those are good points. Why don't we go to Zambone next? And if Karis, if you want to chime in now or afterward, just put your hand up. Is that okay? All right, so Rick, you're up next.
I'm going to take a little bit different approach. And I didn't have the benefit of hearing yet, and I'm sure you're going to talk about it later, the feedback from the select board. As they look to break up town meeting from one massive May town meeting to a couple town meetings, they're going to establish, I believe, that the select board will establish priorities. One of the priorities, obviously, is going to be the town budget. The other thing is going to be some of the union contracts. There may be some discussion about some of the major capital projects that the town has. And then they're going to be looking, in my opinion anyways, to be putting everything else back into October. And particularly the stuff that's easy to do. I don't know how they're going to handle planning board articles. There's only two, I think, in this coming warrant. Both are citizen petitions. But I think it would behoove us to postpone all of our articles until the fall. Having said that, I think it's probably appropriate for us to continue to go forward, maybe not in the April timeframe if we have some additional time available, to meet with the Finance Committee, because if we push off our articles until the fall, then we can also push off and let kind of free up the Finance Committee calendar for that day, and they can always take ours later on. We don't have to vote on ours until after we consult with the Finance Committee, and we're not going to be voting on it till after we have our public hearing. But we can at least postpone, it gives us some flexibility, we can postpone the schedule for the Finance Committee meeting to give them a little bit of benefit. We can also postpone the public hearing. And I think it's important, Peter, as you pointed out, to have the public hearing and to get the feedback from the public on all of the projects. And that way, we know what else we need to compile, put together, and whatever. And we've got 3 months, 4 months to pull that additional information for when it comes time to make the presentations at the fall town meeting. And I just, for one, don't think we should be breaking up the articles. I think we should move them either, you know, as a group. And unless there's some screen that we need to get it done tomorrow, I'd be in favor of pushing them all back to the fall and going through a little bit more defined process as far as scheduling some of these meetings. And I think we'd get a lot of support if we chose to do that, because it takes a lot of the pressure and the burden off of some of the other town government entities that have to deal with this stuff. So that's my 2 cents.
Yeah, that I think that's a good insight. And for those of you who don't know this, but Rick has spent significant time being a member of the Finance Committee, and their approach is rigorous. They come at it, I guess that's the word, in a rigorous way. There's a fair amount of give and take, and I think that if they get jammed up, you're going to hear no before you hear yes. So if we let them, give them time for us to have some give and take with them, we'll likely end up with a better result. And we are definitely missing a planting season. That's what I would call it. But other than that, we're not missing much, and we probably have a lot to gain. I think, and I'm speaking kind of anecdotally, and then after we resolve this issue, I'll talk to you in greater detail about my presentation to the select board last night. But I think anecdotally, this committee is kind of moving in a direction that you often see town boards in need of move, which is in a direction where everyone is feeling comfortable about what the result is going to be. And so I like where we're heading. And I think it's an example of how time gives us an opportunity to work through the process. And I'm speaking really directly about the church articles. We really need to think about it and work through the process. And we've been doing that, frankly, over 2 cycles. And this additional time, I think, will probably give us an opportunity to build a strong consensus one way or the other. I think we're going to get there. And we'll end up with a better result with fewer people in town with a bitter taste in their mouth. Okay, Rick, you're up. You want to talk?
Yeah, just one more point, Peter. I think the other benefit of us postponing all this, by the fall town meeting, there should be a lot more clarity on what they're going to do with the school administration building. And that will help us a little bit as we take a look at the town's plans for CPA money, if you will. Just a thought.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's going to give us, it will be assembled and be deliberating, and we will be able to give them real-time feedback and when we get their proposal. So I'll talk a little bit about that in our next subject, because we did, it came up in our presentation to the board, to the select board, and I'll just touch on that as well. So now let's see, what I'd like to do is, I see everybody in front of me. I want to give the members of the committee one more opportunity to weigh in response to anything we've said, or if you have some additional, brilliant insight that you have come up with. Forget about brilliant insight that you've come up with in the process. Just raise your hand and I'll recognize you. Okay, good. Artie, you're up.
Thanks, Pete. I liked what Rick had to say. I think that was some great insight. Obviously we all want to find a way to move forward with, quote, life as normal when possible. And, and certainly if it's possible to bring some life as normal, starting with the summertime with some of these projects, that would be great. But that being said, a lot of good insight here, a lot of good reasons to put things off to the fall. So, I'm in favor of bringing life back to normal as quick as possible, getting through this health issue. But at the same time, I'm certainly in favor of keeping things going into the fall because of some great insight going on here. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you, Artie. Thanks a lot. All right, and next up is Joe Barnes. Joe.
Peter, after hearing everyone make their contributions, I think it makes more sense to me to continue to keep the articles together and present them in the fall. Some of them may appear on the surface to be not as important as others, unless you're the proponent. And I think the proponents feel very strongly that they're asking for something, some money, some support that is extremely important to them and or their organization. So I think it's a bit of a slight to them if we were to separate them and do some favoritism, if you will, to separate one out and say that these are more important, we need more input. So again, I'd keep them together. I would like to have an open hearing that does bring out a large number of people with strong feelings, that we can get some feedback and we can provide some answers to them as well. So that's my two cents. Hold off till the fall.
That's great, Joe. Thanks again. I saw Bob Dermody's nodding. So we don't record nods, but we do record. But so why don't you weigh in, Bob, and offer your opinion?
Okay, I'm an extrovert, so I'm trying to recreate what it's like to be with me live in the room over there at the town hall. I just wanted to concur with what Joe said. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thank you. Laura, you're up. Laura Dorfman.
I just want to reiterate that the world is going to be so much different even in 3 or 4 months. And I think the delay is appropriate, and I think having them come together, to your earlier point about not wanting to show favoritism or give that appearance, even if we're not, is important. And we don't know what things are going to be like in September. I just think it's a big unknown and it's better to wait.
Okay, good. Thank you. Anyone else with some, Karis? Karis, you have carte blanche. You can break in at any time.
I can mute and unmute anybody anytime. Yep. I was just going to say, we do have one of the other proponents on the at the meeting today, if you wanted to hear from them about the impact that delaying or moving forward would have for them.
All right. So we had already announced that there was going to be no public input, but again, chairman's prerogative. We see that Joe Leghorn, who's the proponent for Community Farms, is present. Karis has got the control here, Joe. She can unmute you. And so let's see. Let's hear. Oh, actually, before we hear from Joe, hold on for a minute. I want to hear from Chris, because Chris had his hand up, and then we're going to turn it over to Joe, who's a member of the public. Okay, so let's hear from Chris. Chris? Nope, can't hear you.
Karis has got to unmute. There we go. No, I think it's great to have this open dialogue that everyone's having here. the key words I'm picking up here, and I just don't think they fit. I don't think it's favoritism towards certain projects. I just think it's the, for lack of a better term, the ease of pushing some of these projects through. Like I mentioned, there's no guarantee, but there are certain projects that I think if we want to go back to normalcy, these projects can somewhat do it. You have programs that are out there. You have people that kind of rely on certain things like this. But again, it's not the favoritism of saying, oh, we think this one's going to go through and the other one's not going to go through. I think it's just kind of the pecking order of where we're looking at it. And I have no problem splitting them. I really don't. I mean, I can sense from the board, everyone wants to push them towards the fall town meeting, but I still have the stance of, I think there's some that could go through in a May town meeting.
Okay. So I think that I don't think that anyone here thinks that we were actually playing with favoritism. It's actually an issue of perception. That's all. So that, and I think that's, there was some more, it's really a perception issue, I think, is what we're talking about. All right, so we've got Rick Zambone up next.
I just wanted to just reiterate, I didn't even consider one project scope versus another. When I was suggesting we move it back, it was irrespective of what the individual scopes of the project were. I'm trying to look at it from an 80,000 foot level and saying, you know, as we try and work through, I mean, we're on some unprecedented turf here. And I think that we need to try and kind of, every once in a while when you're in these types of situations, take a deep breath and say, what's the most practical way to go about doing this, forgetting about what's in the specific article. And I think by postponing them all, and I understand my good colleague Chris there, I sound like I'm in the Senate, what his point is. But I really do think that as a whole, we'd be better off postponing these. And, you know, this is nothing that's urgently earth-shattering, that if we don't do it tomorrow, it's going to cause someone irreparable harm. And I mean, I think that's almost the standard we have to hold this to. Is there something that's going to create an irreparable harm to the proponent? And I don't, you know, in my judgment, just looking at it quickly, there's nothing that would cause irreparable harm. We could postpone it for the 5-6 months. And I think from a, again, 80,000 foot level, I think that's the best move. So that's it. Thanks.
All right. Do we have any other further comments? No? Okay, so now Joe Lakehorn, who's the representative of Needham Community Farms, is here. Let's hear from Joe.
Thank you, Peter. Thanks, Karis. I think where we are now, it just sort of highlighted the criticality of food insecurity and food insecurity for folks in Needham and elsewhere. So looking at this, although it's only a small project, if we are delayed into not having funding until we can do this until spring or fall of 2021, we won't have results in 2022 to come back in 2023 for a project in 2024. And frankly, not knowing where and the impacts of the financial crisis or the health and financial crisis that we're going through, how long we can delay this. I think food insecurity is important. It's a small amount. You know, this is a small organization with small budgets. You know, certainly we will be able to supply food to the food pantry, but can we ramp that up in the future? This will slow it down by, you know, a year or two by delaying it 6 months, because we live by the cycle of the sun.
Okay. All right, but this the farm is running now, but this would be an expansion. This would fuel an expansion of the planting beds, correct? Our understanding is that you might be coming back to us at a later date anyway for additional funding. Is that correct?
Right, but the assumption would be that we would come back with data which would justify further expenditures by the committee. And that's my concern, because we're putting that off. You know, by delaying it 6 months, we may be putting it off by 2 years.
Okay.
But on the other hand, I'm bold and I will say, you know, delay it and I'll come back and say, I think it'll work, and ask for more money anyway. Because, you know, keeping people fed is, at this point in our history, importantly critical.
All right. Any additional comments? And I think what we would do is, at this point, we need a resolution. Is that right, Karis? You may want to unmute there. So,
we would need someone to make a motion.
All right. So the nature of the motion would be to agree to continue the CPC articles from the presently planned May town meeting to the anticipated fall town meeting.
Yes.
Is that what the motion would be?
Yes.
Okay. So have I, Kristen, have I done an adequate job of saying that or no?
If you could say it one more time.
Okay, sure. And it may be, let's do this. If you don't have the background noise, let's take the mutes off, right? This is kind of the point where it's becomes inefficient. So let's do that. Okay. So the motion would be continue the 7 CPC grant applications presently pending for consideration before the CPC from our planned for vote and consideration for placement on our May town meeting to the anticipated October special town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Second.
Discussion.
Okay.
Hearing none, let's have a vote. We're going to do a roll call vote. Okay. And we'll go in order. Barnes?
Aye.
Rocker?
Aye.
Dermody?
Aye.
Dorfman?
Aye.
Ursel? Chris? Ursel?
Sorry, nay.
Zambone?
Aye.
And Pingator is an I. So now, have we recorded the votes, Madam Secretary? Okay.
6-1.
Nope. All right. We've got a couple of comments. It looks like Rick wants to say something.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd suggest that we set some am I okay to speak?
Yeah, go ahead. No, yeah, we're right. Yeah, right.
Okay. I'd suggest we do a couple things as a follow-up to this. One would be to contact the Finance Committee and postpone our meeting with them to a time that would be mutually agreeable. And the second thing is to try and set a date certain for a new public hearing. Not necessarily the date we had originally planned on having it, whatever that was, I forget. But I would suggest we try and do that as kind of a follow-up to this motion.
All right, so what I would say is, I think those are really in the nature of, I don't know that they need to be a motion, but they're housekeeping, I'm sure. So we would ask our staff members to contact Finance Committee, inform them of the resolution, request that we be removed from the April 15th docket for FinCom. And also, I think contact our town clerk and the Needham Channel that we're not going to be having a public hearing on April 2nd. So Rick has suggested that we come up with a date certain. I guess what he's really, his date certain that he's looking at is for a public hearing. I think that's okay. But what we may want to consider doing is asking asking Karis to come back to us with dates in August. I think that's what we're looking at. I don't know that we need to tell her now. How about if we do this? How do you feel about a hearing, public hearing in August?
You're not going to get just a comment on that. I don't think you'll get a lot of public participation. That's why they've kind of shied away from August. I'd almost suggest you try and move it back to a June date versus an August date, but that's just one person's opinion.
Yeah, I'm a little concerned about what's going on in June, but Karis, let's hear from you.
I think we could certainly put something on the schedule, and if for some reason it has to get pushed back because of restrictions, we can always push it back. So maybe a primary date in June and then a backup date in August?
Why, can I interject here? Why would, if we're going to consider making these proposals to the October special town meeting, is there anything wrong with waiting till just after Labor Day when hopefully everyone is back to normal after summer vacations, kids are back in school, hopefully, and people are more engaged in what's going on in town?
We certainly could do that. I think my only concern would be just the turnaround time before town meeting. So we can have a vote that's closer to when the town meeting would be. It wouldn't be recorded. Like, usually the Finance Committee won't vote on their articles until they know how CPC is voting. So it wouldn't be published in the warrant how the FinCom had voted, and sometimes that leads to more questions. That's all.
Okay.
Let me just add a couple things. First of all, my recollection is there's an emergency order that came out today, or that we anticipate coming out, which is going to push town election and town meeting to the June 30th date. I think that's what's going to, we anticipate either the governor signing that order or it's already been issued. Karis, you may have some insight into that.
So right now the town would have to petition the court in order to move our election. The governor is putting forth legislation that would allow the town to do that without petitioning the court. So that's currently what we're waiting on.
So what might happen is we may end up being in a position where we're holding town elections the first week in June. And then this is what I wouldn't be surprised if we ended up holding town elections the first week in June and then having our town meeting the last week in June. I'm going way out on a limb, but that's what I wouldn't be surprised if that's what the place we ended up in. So now, in terms of we should have our public hearing, June doesn't look that great. And I do understand, Rick, your concerns about August. I really do. And I'm worried that the time that we're buying for kind of interplay between FinCom and this committee and the public and these potentially controversial articles is going to be lost if we push it all off until September. So I really do. I think we may have a difficult time with August in terms of attendance, but we do know enough to know that August is not a flu season. That's a target time when we're probably going to be able to go significant people out in the public. You're right, they may be on vacation. I guess we'd have to think about that. I don't know if July is, so I think June is not a good date because I think we're going to be having town meeting. I think September is not a good date because we give away all the time that we're going to do to approach this and work it up the right way and get the right attention and feedback from FinCom and from our citizen, or from our citizens. So I do think we're looking at July and August. Those do have drawbacks, they do. But that's, you know, is July, does anyone have any insight into whether or not July is better than August?
I don't, I think you can hear me. I can't see July being a great month. People could be, under normal circumstances, that would be a horrendous month to have people being around in the town. And I don't know if it's going to be any better this year. People could be going stir crazy in many ways.
All right, so that's now let's go around the horn then. I think yeah. Your hand is up.
Yeah, my concern is if we get through this thing in, let's say, June, and who knows, the pent-up, you know, feeling of getting away and doing something, you know, with your family and taking a trip and enjoying summer, I think is going to take a lot of people out of town. But we don't know when this is going to end either, so that's just hypothetical at this point.
Peter, my two cents on that is I believe schools are going back before Labor Day. So it might be a good approach to do it the first week that school's back in session, because most of the people will be back in town for that. That you have the subject to confirm that, but I'm pretty sure that this year they're going back before Labor Day. So
I'm first.
Consider that as a good target.
I agree.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent idea. So let's shoot for that week. And then think about for the liaisons who are working on the church projects. We need to think about the parameters of the agreement. We can't really deal with that until we vote. I'm just trying to figure out if there's some work that we can do between now and our next meeting. I'm thinking out loud here. I suppose we could have another meeting at some point, kind of a wrap-up meeting before we adjourn. We've got April 13th as a potential date, and I guess that's a possibility. How do people feel about that? We could do it on Zoom again. And so I'm thinking out loud, kind of a wrap-up meeting before adjournment, if there's homework that can be done between in the period of time between April and August, what is it that we can do so that we can be in a position to address these issues efficiently in the fall. So that's kind of my question. I see that, okay, we got a few hands up. Laura, let's go with you first.
How do we communicate this delay in the the articles to the people who have requested the funds? Is that something that is done through like an official, you know, notification from the town, or is it done by the liaisons to the people submitting the projects? Because they're probably gonna want to have questions and want to understand.
Okay. So I think that's probably could be dealt either with through the liaison or through our staff. I think in terms of consistency of messaging, it probably makes sense for us to have our staff members do that communication. And there could be an invitation for them, the proponents, to contact Karis or to contact their liaisons if they want to discuss the matter further. Does that make sense to you, Karis?
I just think we have to have a consistent message.
I understand that. Go ahead.
I can notify them and then have them reach out to their liaisons afterward for follow-up.
Okay, good. That's great. All right, I saw a couple of hands up. I'm gonna get to everybody. Let's go with Dermody.
I withdraw my hand.
Okay. Artie.
The question is this for the group. What if one of the organizations, once I hear, what if one of the organizations borrows the money from some other means to get the project going so it's not delayed on the, obviously on the hoax, let's say, that in the fall town meeting that the CPC or the town will vote for the funds? How does that impact?
Tell them not to do that. That's a problem with when you're requesting CPC funds. Basically, CPC funds cannot be used to replenish reserve. So that would not be advisable. Right, Karis? Karis? Yes, okay, she said yes. Okay. All right, yes, okay. All right, so now we got Chris. Chris, you're up.
I kind of want to go back to what my distinguished colleague, Mr. Zambone, said. I like the idea of a June meeting, or at least a talk about this, because we're going through times we've never been through before, but then we're assuming everybody's going to be on vacation in July and August. I don't think that's fair to the proponents. I mean, we know what's going on right now. We're dealing with times that we've never dealt with, and we're making the changes that we need to when we're adapting to this. But to assume everyone's going to be on vacation in July and August, that's kind of not the right way. I think we need to go to the proponents. I think if we have something in June, because kids aren't going back to school till May 1st, I think we should know by June where we kind of stand. And I think a meeting of that time, or at least talking about some of these things, would be a perfectly time scheduled to do this.
Okay, so what you're proposing is not necessarily a public hearing in June, meeting in June to discuss where we go next.
I would even, you know, look at both. Yeah, well, having a public.
Well, why do we why don't we take it sequentially? Why don't we have a public meeting? Why don't we have a meeting in June and see where things are changing daily, see where we're at, and then have it in early June. We need to publish. I think we need, Karis is going to know the answer to this, but public hearings, there's a publishing requirement. So we need at least, I think, 14 days notice. Is that right, Karis?
Yeah, it's 2 weeks in advance. So if we had met before 14 days in advance, that would give us a good idea whether or not we could hold the meeting or not.
Okay. So I think those are great ideas. So let's do this. Let's have let's hold on to our April 13th meeting, be short, but let's hold on to our April 13th meeting. Our April 13th meeting, we can come up with a space for June to meet and potentially to have a public hearing. Every day is a little different, so we'll have some different data points in 2 weeks. But I think that those are good points. So how do people feel about that? Anyone?
It sounds like a good plan, Peter.
Okay, it's
a good. I like that idea.
Makes sense.
I agree. I think the key is to find something before that June date where we can meet with the finance committee, get their input, because we're going to need some time to address whatever concerns the select board had and the finance committee had. We could use that time.
Yeah, we don't need to meet with the finance committee between now and June. We probably are not going to have that opportunity. But we can meet with the finance committee in July or August, I think. I don't know if you're saying, I just want to be clear.
Yeah, Peter, what I was saying was the finance committee doesn't meet in July and August usually. And they usually don't meet in June for that matter either. But this is a new set of circumstances. So I think you should just maybe, you know, perhaps you talk to the chair of the finance committee or Karis talks to Louise Misgird to find out, you know, get their input on when the meeting should be. And, you know, we can maintain a fairly flexible schedule. It's not the whole group that goes to the finance committee meeting anyway. So, I tend to do that and then, you know, kind of compile what the finance committee's input is, what the select board's committee input is, and then finally we'll have what the public hearing is whenever we decide to do that. So it may help us in the presentation before the public hearing, because a lot of the questions are going to be the same. So just a thought.
All right, I just want to make sure we have some clarity here. So let's, in terms of our next meeting, I think we'll have our next meeting on April 13th. Does that make sense to you, Karis?
So the next meeting would be April 13th at 7:30 via Zoom?
Yeah, does that make sense to you?
Yep.
Okay. And then from there, we'll talk about June, and we'll get some data from on FinCom, okay? Got hands up, so let's go with Artie. Artie?
Yeah, Peter, since I brought up that, you know, the possibility of what happens if someone borrows the money, the other question is this: what happens if any of these entities start the project before this, before the money is voted on? Does that classify as the same thing? For example, the first chair, the first parish, they do the work on the project before it's even voted on. I mean, the job is complete.
That's why they need to know where we stand and what the timing is, I think.
Yeah, but what happens if they actually do the project over the summertime? Now it's complete.
I think I answered that question, which is that's not advisable. That means that they're getting the money from someplace else, and CC funds can't be used to replenish reserves.
Okay, well, that's my main point, for example. So none of these entities can even technically really start the project if they want us to then vote on it in October. They can't start on it before then. Is that true?
Right. Well, sure. I mean, I guess that's the way it works. I mean, they're coming to us asking us for funds in order to fund a proposal, you know, and so if we don't vote on them and there's no disbursement, then they can't do their project. And my point is that it's not advisable for them to start the project and come back and basically ask for a repayment of what they've already expended. I will say, I think there's probably a little bit of wiggle room in that. I would not advise them to do that. That's kind of, I've heard of other towns and other entities doing that. I don't think that's a very good idea, because I think that there's some pretty strict language in the statute. I don't have it in front of me now, but I think that that would be a cause for concern. So if they say those things, well, first of all, please don't suggest. First of all, we haven't had a vote. We haven't had a public hearing. They don't know if they're getting their money or not. So they should not take any action in reliance of some promise that they're going to be getting their money. It's just going to be delayed. And, you know, certainly if they have a question like that, can we do the project now and get paid later? Please have them, that's got to be a question that they should direct to the committee and to our staff person so that we can give them some good advice. We don't want them to be in a position where they put themselves unwittingly in a compromised position. Is that fair, Karis? Okay. All right. So now we're working on this incrementally, but we have an April 13th meeting, and we'll come up with some proposal for what we're going to do in June.
Peter, I've seen two hands, just like Bob and Chris.
Oh, I apologize. Okay, Bob, you're up.
Thank you. I concur with what you just said, but Peter, about our proponents. I want to stress that I think we need to endeavor to treat all our applicants the same. So I'm in favor of Karis reaching out to them in a more official capacity than a phone call from a liaison. More than happy to talk with them after that notice is sent to them. I think all the proponents should know how they're all being treated. And just a comment on Artie's question, I might be of the opinion that if a project is started, there's no proposal because they're asking for money for work that doesn't exist. The work is already done. So, and I could see how that could happen, but we need to protect the town. We work for the town and we represent our constituents of the town of Needham, not necessarily the proponents, although some of them are the same people. but I think it's our job to represent the townspeople. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. All right, so now we've got, I think Chris had his hand up. It's Chris?
No, sorry, that was a nervous twitch. Mr. Dermody makes me very nervous, so I twitched by accident.
Okay, so good. No other then, right? So now let's move on to our next item, which is Chairman's update, and I'm going to make this very brief. I presented to the Select Board last night, and dialing in, by the way, I reviewed with them the seven current applications. And I think what I tried to do was help give them a sense of where we were at in our deliberations, without, of course, understanding that we hadn't voted on anything. But in that spirit, kind of talk to them a little bit about what our issues were with the church applications, the fact that we had legal counsel advising us, and that we were coming up with some principles that we probably would feel comfortable applying on a going forward basis to those kinds of institutions. And I said the principles that seem to be evolving are substantial contribution, if they can, by the proponent, and some protections for our investment in case the property is sold under a clawback agreement. And then kind of reminding the Select Board that there could be private entities that would actually could come to us that have historic structures and look for grants, and that we have other tools available to us, including requirements of public access, but that we had a sense with respect to the churches that that's what they do every night. They open their doors to the citizens of this town through other organizations, and that's kind of that public access that the town gets and the benefit that we get without a formal agreement with respect to that. And then the other matters were kind of, you know, walk them through that. But I would say that it was all, I would say that there was a really high level of comfort with what I had said and where we were going. There was one select member who raised the question about expending money for historic preservation and cautioned about how that might impact the planned use of funds for Emory Grover. And I may have said more than I should have, but I thought that I wanted to treat them fairly and say that there was a sense of the committee that the financial models that we had seen, that was a very big commitment, and that we were we were struggling with the idea that basically everything but what was put in reserve funds and what was matched by the state would be expended between those but the bonded projects for a period of years, and there was a fair amount, I don't know if I called it resistance, but I said that the sense of the board was that they were not favorable about that kind of financial modeling that we had seen. They didn't want to, and I think that they said, and I said, I don't know where we're going to come out on what even the request is going to be in terms of Emory Grover and whether or not it's a rehab in addition, it's a facade, it's a new building, it's a new site. But I felt in fairness that we wanted to give them what the sense of the board was. I think one of the benefits of the delay even now is that, you know, come June, we probably will continue to get further additional information. But I wanted to just kind of, you know, I thought that I wanted to fairly represent that. But that's kind of an issue that's going to be a discussion point for this committee, and that we're not going to just, you know, we would have some difficulty with an $11 million bonding commitment. So I thought, in fairness, they would need to know that. But that's for the subject of a discussion for another day, is what they basically said to me. So that's, and I think I think the two points that I wanted to take away from that, two takeaway points for the committee are, I think that they liked our work. They knew that we were doing it seriously. They liked our approaches with the, you know, the two church articles. And they probably, you know, it was probably fair for us to give them some feedback on where we were, what we were thinking was in terms of future expenditures in connection with the Emory Grove project. But, you know, nothing is set in stone, but I wanted to be an accurate reporter to them of where, what our thinking was. All right, so I heard, I saw a hand up, and that's Rick.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, Peter, thank you. I'm just curious, what was the, when you gave them that discussion point about the capacity and the bonding and so on and so forth, did you get any feedback, a reaction, or just, okay, thanks?
Yeah, actually, it was more than that. It was, we're not going to discuss that tonight. I think that was the statement made to me by the chair. So I wasn't trying to overstep my bounds, but I thought that I was just trying to be fair with everyone.
Okay, fair enough, thank you.
Okay, any other comments? Okay, so, all right, so we are gonna reconvene on April 13th. I do not know that we have any other issues to address tonight. I just wanna once again thank Karis and Kristen. And please thank all of our town employees for the work that you do. Really appreciate it. Kristen's been really, Karis has just been really helpful throughout this process. And so I want to thank you, Karis, and on behalf of the committee and Kristen too. That's, you make us sound so smart in those minutes, Kristen. I don't know how you do it. Okay, so, but thank you. And any other comments? Chris, first of
all. So Chris had a question about April 13th and that it's the date is a Monday. Peter, do you want to explain why and make sure that that works for everyone?
I think that, yeah, there's a possibility. Well, we can, if the town election is held on the 14th, the next day, then my term as a member of the committee would technically end there as representative of the housing authority. So that may change, you know, because the town election may be continued. But that's why I'm not doing that. It's not a vanity project on my behalf either. If you guys want to meet on Wednesday, I'm just telling you, I may or may not be there. That's all. And you know, the scary thing is that Rick Zambone may take over.
Chris is okay with that.
You do great.
What's that?
I'm fine with Monday, April 13th. I will be at my Zoom computer ready to go at 7:30.
Okay.
Question for Karis. Next meeting, I suspect we log in the same way we did this time, but is there a different ID number for the meeting? Will that have different numbers? Okay.
Yep, I'll be sending that out probably a day or two in advance of the meeting.
Thank you, Bob.
Any other final thoughts or final comments by anyone? Okay, Bob Dermody.
I see some names that I do not recognize. I want to make sure we allow anybody from the public or whoever else attended to speak, if that's appropriate protocol in the view of the chair.
I think what we've heard from Joe Lakehorn, and I think that Russ Donalds also is the other member of the public. Russ, thanks, by the way, for being here. If you have anything to offer,
Yeah, I'm trying to catch up on the procedures and processes of this organization. I am running for commissioner of the Needham Housing Authority. So.
Okay, good. All right.
So I'm hoping we hold elections.
Okay, good. All right. Yeah, I don't think the elections will be suspended.
No.
Okay. All right. I guess that's it. Everyone has had their say. And so let's have a motion. I'll make a motion to adjourn. Can I have a second?
Second.
Okay. So you've got to do a roll call again. Okay, so that's a roll call vote. So we'll start with Barnes.
Aye.
Thacker.
Aye.
Dermody.
Aye.
Dorfman.
Aye.
Bursell. Chris.
Oh, sorry. I had to mute him because his it keeps on picking up the background noise.
Zambone. Zambone.
Hi. Folks, stay safe.
Hi. Okay. All right, we're adjourned. Stay safe. We will see you.